start with a small story I had. A friend of mine who's my running buddy, about a month back, he said, now that all the uncertainties are behind us, should I go really long on the market? It was the beginning of July, and he came up with the WhatsApp forward. So he says, statistics is also behind me, supporting this thing. Elections are over. Should I go long? Then I told him, no, we are going through a slowdown a little bit. We are yet to kind of fix all those issues. Monsoon is coming in. We don't know how it's uncertainty of the monsoon. So I would say that you wait for July to pass through. And then he says, then which month then I should really go bullish? I said, yeah, you can avoid August, September, November, December, Jan, Feb. Basically avoid any short-term calls kind of a thing. With that, I will probably quickly take you through our current thinking on the growth, global growth, local growth, markets. As you might be seeing in this chart, global growth has been continuously going down. Last 10-year average GDP growth is about 2.6% for developed markets. The previous 10-year is about 3.6%. So we have structurally moved to a 1% lower GDP growth on the world, especially on the developed markets over the last 10 years. And more recently, we have seen marking down of the global growth for various reasons. People attribute trade tensions, disruptions in technologies, etc., wageless, jobless growth globally as many reasons why this GDP is not, growth is not accelerating globally. Emerging markets are holding up in terms of GDP growth, whereas advanced economies are still, I would say, struggling with growth, if not for a better word. But having said that, am I really worried about growth from a global perspective? No. I think, are there any excesses in the world market today which is going unseen, unnoticed, like what happened in 2007-8? I don't think such speculative bubbles or excesses are existing at this juncture. And we'll come to that one more, through one more slide, saying that where there has been a steady trend down of inflation and interest rates globally. Interest rates went up for a while, and now again they have started to come down in US and most other European markets as well. Inflation has been structurally going down both in developed markets as well as in emerging markets. Emerging market inflation is a very big story. If some of you who understand very well the linkages between inflation and interest rates, emerging markets used to have something like 4 to 5% differential in inflation versus developed markets. And that's the reason we used, most of the emerging markets used to have very high interest rates. What has happened over the last 10, 15 years is that the differential in inflation between EM and DMs have gradually narrowed, and many markets, therefore, the interest rates have also, differentials have also started narrowing, barring a few markets like India, where I still think that interest rates differentials are way too high, given the inflation differentials. Third thing on the global is leverage. Most of the people, when they talk about global markets, are worried about what is the debt in developed market, what is the debt in the emerging market. The dotted line is the debt in the developed market. The blue dotted line is the debt in the debt in India. This gray bar is the debt in emerging market. As you might notice, the emerging market debt to GDP is not, it's going up, but not at an alarming rate. India has a remarkably stayed flat. The biggest change that has happened over the last decade is China, where we are seeing debt to GDP has gone closer to developed market levels. So if at all, there is one point of worry at this juncture in terms of global leverage, it's probably China and not so much any other developed market or any other emerging market. Markets have been very tepid over the last 1 year. I mean, overall markets gave some 2-3% return, equity markets. Various countries stacked up, but the best performing indices are mostly developed market indices. 9.5% Dow Jones, S&P 500, 8.2. If you look at the world index, 3.6. MSCI was minus 1.37. So it's not a great year for emerging market equities, if you look at it from a one-year perspective, and commodities also remain pretty soft. So overall, my view, Franklin Templeton's view, is that while global growth is still remaining anemic, there are no major bubble kind of risks out in the space. Leverage is under control, excepting China. Inflation differentials have come down between developed market and emerging market, and therefore interest rates differentials are also structurally trending down. These are the two, three takeaways I would like you to remember from the bigger picture out there. Coming to India, we have done reasonably well but despite the recent slowdown. GDP has been slowing down in the last couple of years, but we have come off from the very low levels in 2012-13, and we are now probably settling around 6.5 to 7% kind of a GDP growth rate. I mean, all these numbers are known. The parameters are things like fiscal deficit, which is under kind of tolerable level, central and state fiscal deficit put together. While it has come off, but it is refusing to go down below this 6% level. So this has got its implication for fixed income market as well as overall economy. That truly we will make further improvement if state fiscal deficits also start to come down and government kind of borrows less from the overall system. I mean, this chart tells you government revenues growth and expenditure growth. The clear trend is both are coming down. The revenue growth is also coming down and expenditure growth is also come down. The key reason being there's a nominal growth. The key reason is the inflation coming down determines the revenues of the government. If the government still thinks that they can keep spending at the rate of 15% growth, but the revenues are growing to grow at only 11-12%, we have a serious problem. If you look at the government's annual budget, the budget growth is on an average 13-15%, much higher than the nominal GDP growth. So that we need to be aware that government's revenues are under stress, or I wouldn't call it stress, it's kind of growth is falling down, and so are the expenditures at this juncture. External account is pretty solid. At this juncture, CAD, we are at close to 0%, between 0 to 2%. Currency reserves are still building up. INR is reasonably stable. I have no major negative news on this front. Inflation also pretty benign. So from a macroeconomic perspective, we do have moderate growth, extremely moderate inflation, stable current account, stable currency, which is all you can ask for. That kind of stability is all you can ask for in this environment. Industrial production is generally, I would say, is low. The growth is hovering between 0 to 5%. Off late, it has come off from 5 to 2-3%. Manufacturing PMI is again trending towards 50, the 50 mark. 50 means above 50 is acceleration, below 50 is deceleration. This is Purchasing Managers Index, and that has been decelerating since November 2018. We are yet to see a meaningful reversal of this trend. Interest rates, I'm sure we will listen to more of it. This chart is not updated. It's come off a little bit down to 5.75. And probably market is expecting further cut in repo rates and reverse repo rates in the next meeting of RBI. Clearly, there is headroom from a macroeconomic perspective to cut rates and to ensure use monetary stimulus to drive aggregate demand. Near-term growths are looking pretty bleak. I will use some parameters to highlight this. These are automobile sales, two-wheelers, passenger vehicles, tractor sales. All of them are plummeting. You are aware of it. It's all there in the headlines. I'm just giving you a long period chart. So tractor sales used to be around 20%. It's gone minus 10%. Two-wheeler, which is pretty stable growth it used to have, it's gone. And the passenger car sales is down. I mean, previous time it was down was in 2013, such a low number. Currently, we are at minus 10. If you look at some other parameters like cement output, the growth is declining. Capital goods is anyway not growing very highly. And some of the services sector, this is one of the high frequency indicator we all track and very early indicator of economic activity, which is air passenger traffic growth. If you look at it, from May onwards, the deceleration started. From November, it started plunging down. Today, the traffic growth is close to 0%. People can attribute various reasons for it, but essentially, it's a very good barometer of business sentiments, household sentiments in terms of travel and tourism. And we are seeing some significant deterioration there, services, exports. And finally, the personal loans. I mean, one of the things that has been growing pretty well over the last few years have been the growth in the personal loans. People have been borrowing money and spending. People have been borrowing money. These are unsecured personal loans given by the system, banks, NBFCs, credit card companies, etc. We are seeing a serious deceleration of that. Last time we saw that was during the demand period, and we are seeing similar kind of a trend at this juncture. So overall picture is, while the macroeconomic stability is there in terms of GDP growth, fiscal deficit, inflation, interest rates, etc., we do seem to be having a very severe short-term issue in terms of growth, as is visible by both consumer spending growth as well as the non-consumer spending kind of a trends. Some of it is cyclical. They will kind of mend itself out. Some of it would require stimulus from the government or stimulus from the monetary authorities. Monetary authorities are doing their own bit by dropping interest rates. Government wanted to probably stimulate it. The best way to stimulate aggregate demand is? Can anyone help me? The best way to fiscally stimulate aggregate demand is to, pardon? That is monetary stimulus. Fiscally, how would you stimulate? Either government spends a lot of money, which anyway it was spending, otherwise they'll ask us to spend a lot of money. The only way they can ask us to spend a lot of money is to cut taxes, like the way Trump has done. Like, you cut taxes, put more money in the hands of people, they will go and spend, and that spending will lead to aggregate demand. So cutting taxes was the best possible alternative available to the government, and I think they missed that opportunity in the last budget, and that's why there is a deep disappointment amongst the market participants on the track that is taken by the government to get the growth back. Government spending money alone is not going to get the growth back. People need to spend money. For that, you need consumer confidence and business confidence. Business confidence will come back by cutting interest rates, making credit available easily. Consumer confidence will come back if you cut taxes. I think that not there has been the biggest disappointment in the last budget. Otherwise, I would say that we are pretty okay. Moving to corporate scenario. Corporate and markets, let me put it that way. Last 1 year, in rupee term, markets delivered about 11% return, driven by few sectors, not every sector, driven by few sectors. Banking sector and banking and financial services and IT are the primary sectors. Consumer durable is the third sector, which is still, till December 2018, it was still doing well. So it was kind of, all the stocks did pretty well in that space. Most other sectors have anemic performance: auto, metals, small cap, healthcare, and then FMCG. Even a defensive sector, which has been growing well, like FMCG sector. So the biggest driver in the market in terms of performance has been financials, banks, and IT. If you look at the earnings buildup for the next couple of years, which is pretty good, sorry, this chart is not very highly visible. I will probably read it out. The bulk of the earnings growth is coming from banking and financial services. This is private banks, this is PSU banks. Put together, they account for about 7-8% of the earnings growth. Oil and gas and technology each account for 4-4% of the earnings growth. So between these four sectors, you probably have about 15-16% of the incremental earnings growth. Other sector, automobile is contributing to zero, and then telecom is expected to continue to be zero. Utilities, healthcare, metals, all very anemic profit growth. So while this aggregate number looks good in terms of earnings growth, bulk of the earnings growth is coming from four sectors: banking and financial services, IT, and oil and gas. And most other sectors are very, very moderate slowly growing, probably less than 10% kind of a EPS growth rate. So growth being this moderate, we have seen continuous increase in the valuation in terms of PER. While price to book is not going up, PER of the market is going up, and market itself is not going up. So what should be happening? Market itself has not gone up, price to book is not going up, but PER is going up, which means essentially profits are coming down for the aggregate indices. There are a few loss-making companies in the index. Few of these companies are pushing the PER to very high levels. If you are normalized for them, I would say the PE is closer to 21, 22 kind of a number. Currently, it is showing 25, 26. But price to book and price market cap to GDP, the other metrics of valuation look pretty okay. All of you intuitively know that markets have been correcting, though it is not reflected in the aggregate index that well. We have seen more wider correction in the mid caps, wider correction in the small caps. So clearly it is not captured well in the PERs of the frontline indices because of a few outliers in the system. Finally, I think in terms of people ask us, has the correction been over? Is overdone in the mid and small caps? So this is a good chart to spend some time on. This was a time where mid and small caps used to trade at some discount to large caps. The discounts can be, you know, 10, 20% valuation discount. So if a large cap used to trade at 15 PE, same sector, a mid-cap company would trade at 13 PE or 12 PE. So there was always some bit of a comfort in buying a mid-sized company because it is available optically at cheaper valuation. But somewhere along 2015, this curve inverted and we saw the reverse. Mid and small caps became 30, 40, 50% premium to large cap. The reasons are very many. They were delivering better growth. Second is more money was chasing them. Most of the domestic investors who came into the market loved buying mid and small caps. I mean, they have, because all said and done, the best way to make long period wealth is to buy a company when it is small or mid-size and then grow with it. So everyone believed in it and they went and bought lots of it within a very short period of time. And that led to massive expansion in valuations. Thanks to the correction, we are now seeing the premiums have come to pretty much to zero. So now I can't say that it is expensive, mid and small caps. It has come to, maybe one wants to buy it at discount to large caps, which means you have to wait for a little bit. But I would say the bulk of the risk that was there in the market, which was significant overvaluation of mid and small caps, is kind of behind us, thanks to the steep corrections that we have seen. And also to some extent, the large caps have also relatively performed better than the mid and small caps over the last couple of years. Combination of both put together has made mid and small caps relatively better. So if any of your clients have large exposures, have built or were wanting to cut and did not cut, this is not the time to cut. They may continue. They should continue to hold on. If some of your clients were underinvested, missed the last rally in terms of mid and small caps, this may be a useful time to start building a core allocative position to mid and small cap funds. Portfolio flows, domestic flows are pretty good. And even if you look at last year, blue bar is foreign portfolio investors, green bar is domestic investors. So blue bar was negative in 2018, and whereas it was more than adequately compensated by the domestic buyers. 2019, we saw the reversal in the first 5 months, where the foreigners started buying in large quantity, whereas domestics were not buying that much. But in the last 1 month, we have seen again the reversal of this trend, where foreign portfolio investors have started selling aggressively, and whereas domestics are trying to absorb that supply. The reason for FPA selling is essentially more to do with, I would say, the growth coming down for the domestic economy, as well as some of the tax changes that is impacting the foreign portfolio investors. You all know the tax changes. We discussed about it yesterday. Sanjay also kind of went at length on that. So Some of the tax changes have spooked the foreign portfolio investors, and we are seeing the reaction. Hopefully, it will kind of slow down over the next couple of months, and we would expect the foreign investors to moderate their selling over the next quarter or so. This is an analysis of performance of, let's say, BSE NSE 100 or NSE 500. I think NSE 500 is a better indication because it kind of covers the broader market. Last 1 year, NSE 500 gave on an aggregate basis 6.58%. 10 stocks accounted for all of it, almost. If you look at financials, out of 6.58, more than close to 5% was delivered by financials alone. So 2018-19 was a period where there was a massive normalization in the valuation of financials. So most of the stressed banks came out of stress. Most of them moved from a very extremely depressed valuation to a more normal valuation. Because of that, you had this big contribution of returns from financials in the last year. Their earnings have still not come back to normalcy, but the valuations have come back to normalcy. Current year is when the earnings will come to normalcy, but market is already reasonably discounting the normalization of this earnings recovery. And we saw the whole lot of other stocks, which are a combination of automobiles, pharmaceuticals, and few of the financial companies, few stressed corporates, many of them fell by a very large percentage in the bottom. Most other sectors did not deliver any return. So even within the stock level attribution of performance, it's a very, very narrow market, and that I would like you to think about it. What we are seeing is not a very broad earnings growth, broad-based earnings recovery at this juncture. Few companies which were under stress came back to normalcy, and few others which were more leveraged to consumers kind of remained stable in this environment. Most other companies have severe challenges in terms of delivering growth and profit growth in the current environment. Few words on what are the disruptions that is happening in the marketplace. Many of you will be aware of it. The primary disruption is on the lending side. We have seen big growth of NBFCs. This is in China, they call it shadow banking. In India, we call them non-banking financial corporations. If you look at NBFC's share of lending, before fiscal 15-16, it used to be 15% of overall lending pie. Over the last 4 years, from 15, they are now contributing to 24% of systemic lending. So any economy where we are seeing dramatic shift in the way credit is made available, there are going to be certain skews and distortions that will get set in. And that is what we have seen over the last 3-4 years. The strong growth of NBFC has its own problems, and we are now currently at the receiving end of those problems. This is NBFCs lending to credit. This is banks lending to NBFCs. If you look at the red line, banks are also, instead of them lending directly to the marketplace, they have taken a more easier route of giving their money to the non-banking financial companies, and then they tell you, go and lend in the market, because I don't want to go and lend for various reasons. So what we have seen in the last 3 years is that banks driving credit growth through NBFCs, and that is kind of changing at the margin. Now we are seeing, what we are seeing now is that there has been a rollback of the growth that is provided by NBFCs, and this is clearly visible. If you look at mutual funds, exposure to NBFC sector, in August 2018, it was 30%. SEBI limit is about 40%. 30, 30, 27, 25, and it is falling. So even mutual funds are cutting back their lending to NBFCs. So again, the reasons are well known. So clearly, we are in the middle of a big rebalancing, readjustment in terms of the financial services sector. The credit growth driver, which used to be non-banking financial companies, is now moving back into the banking system, and this is not going to happen seamlessly. There are going to be pockets of disruption, vacuum in lending. Not all segments which NBFCs were lending will be lent by banking system. So that disruption is going to create some bit of trouble in the real economy, and we have to watch out for that. So in summary, I would say that while the corporate health is good, the growth has really come off. Valuations are okay from a price-to-book perspective, despite there is overvaluation in high-growth segments. Whichever companies which have delivered growth in this challenging environment are sitting on very, very rich and expensive valuation. Any small disappointment would lead to reasonable valuation contraction in those companies. We are already seeing some of the high-growth companies which were trading at high valuations kind of go through some bit of a valuation reset. FPA flows have turned negative, whereas DIA flows are still supportive. We are still following a very reasonably cautious and approach. We are not taking too much risks because growth is not, I would say, widely prevalent. It is not across all sectors. Even within sectors, there is a huge divergence of growth between A company and B company. And our general strategy, therefore, is to focus on fewer companies and ensure that the near term is not excessively challenged. We don't mind it being slightly challenged, but not excessively challenged, and kind of keep working to improve the quality of your stocks in the portfolio on a medium-term basis. Some of the longer-term trends, what are the things that are kind of making us excited about the market is there are still pockets of consumption which are very nascent, which have a very 5-10 period years of brilliant growth ahead. I think consumer durables is one thing. So we play it through some air conditioner companies, some other household appliances company. We think retailing, organized retailing is a big play. Though we don't have too many listed companies, to the extent possible, where it is available, we have kind of focused on companies that are doing, focusing more on organized retailing, branded retailing, etc. I think that is another area which we are pretty excited about. We also think that companies, financial companies, which enable these consumers to kind of buy these goods and services on a structural basis are well positioned. So kind of retail lending institutions are a good place to be in. But within that, I want to make a nuance. Not all retail lending institutions are great. Some of them are taking extremely high risks, giving lots of unsecured loans. And we want to be very clear. I would rather go for a moderately growing retail lending company rather than extremely high growth retail company. There are some other disruptions that are playing. I think there is a part of the segment in the economy where businesses are moving from informal sector to formal sectors, and that is another good play to play. A lot of building and construction material companies fall in this. Even financing is a good example for moving from informal sector to formal sector. And that is technology. There are many business models are going through structural changes, and we are seeing a whole lot of companies adopt technologies in the way we have never seen, much like what is happening in other parts of the world. So can the companies cut dramatically their costs by using newer and newer technologies, better automation of their processes, etc.? And if we can get convinced, then we go whole long into that kind of companies in our portfolios. And that is another, I would say, medium to long-term trend. Whenever a company says, I'm going to adopt a wide technology, and which will help me to become a cost leader, and therefore a market share leader, I am very excited to hear that kind of story. This is a story which is yet to kind of, which is kind of plays on and off infrastructure. It is still driven by government. The current government has not done a great job of co-opting private infrastructure companies into the development of infrastructure. So there are not too many private companies to play it, but at some point of time, we would see many private companies play into it, especially on the railway capex. So we expect some meaningful ideas in that space. Corporate deleveraging is another trend. Some businessmen are stressed at this juncture. We are going through a bit of a churn in the corporate world. Gone are the days where a businessman who is successful in A business can start a B, C, D business and be successful. It's no longer granted or can be taken for granted that if a person is successful in, let's say, infrastructure, can be successful in consumer lending, or in telecom, etc. What we have seen, however, unfortunately, is many Indian promoters exactly do the same thing. That is, if you are good in consumer staples, you go and build a cement plant. If you are good in petrochemical and refining, you go and do e-commerce. The right to win is not automatic. Many of them, in fact, fail, and they realize it much later, and now the cost of failure is very high. And what we are seeing is there is this sudden downpour of risk on the marketplace, and suddenly the promoters are realizing that they are probably juggling too many balls in the air. And in the process, what is most vital to that, they are dropping. There are stories in the marketplace where promoters are forced to sell the apple of their eye, the most cherished business which they have today, to sell that and to get out of the leveraging issue. So we are going through a very big churn in the corporate entrepreneurial space, and I am not sure that it's over. It's going to take a lot more time. But at the end of it, what we will have is a fairly focused set of entrepreneurs who will keep doing certain kind of businesses and its adjacencies and not go too wide into too many businesses. India will have to have a new set of entrepreneurs who are more focused, who are more, I would say, have come ground up for us to go into a more sustainable path. Today, we are having big conglomerates, and barring one or two businesses in the conglomerate, most others are stressed. So this is actually going to be a big issue from, it has already been a big issue, but I would expect it to play out over the next 3-4 years.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.